Today's video, we shall be discussing fetal echocardiography, and we'll try to make this complex topic simpler for you. We did a recent poll on our social media platforms, and more than 70% of you said that you're not very comfortable with fetal echo. And the goal of this presentation is to make that easier for you. Our speaker today is Dr. Anirudh Badade. He is the director of Chikitsa Ultrasound and Training and Diagnostic Center. It's one of the best training center in Mumbai, India for postgraduate medical students. And he has trained more than 4,000 medical graduates so far in different subspecialties of ultrasound. Without wasting any further time, I would request Dr. Badade to take over and start his presentation. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Amar, for the kind introduction. And I will start the screen share. Right. The topic today is fetal echocardiography made easy. And as you know, fetal echocardiography is a very large topic. And so we can't finish that in one lecture. So I've called this as lecture number one. Now, I'm from Chikitsa Ultrasound Training Institute. We have fellowships, 6 month and 12 month fellowships, and shorter courses. Basically, people finish their post-graduation, and these are our contact details and the website and this new Instagram webpage, Instagram page, which has been made by a very promising young Dr. Disha Lokhandwala. Now, when we start, now at the outset, what I would like to say is that when we do obstetric ultrasound examination, there are four types of obstetric ultrasound examinations. The first trimester scan, then what is called as the second or third trimester standard or routine ultrasound scan. Then there are specialized ultrasound scans. And then there are limited ultrasound examinations. So there are mainly four types of obstetric ultrasound examinations. And then if you look at the first trimester scan, we are going to look at the number of fetuses and the heart activity. And we also look at the anatomy, particularly at the time of the NT scan. And the so-called standard or second trimester ultrasound examination is in that we, apart from the fetal number, placenta, biometry, we need to do what is called as the anatomic survey. And the anatomic survey is a fairly extensive study, what we in India call as the anomaly scan. So what we call the anomaly scan in India is labeled as the standard or second or third trimester examination in the by the American associations, which is the ACR, the ACOG, and the AIUN. So the guidelines of 2013 have prescribed this kind of classification. Third type of examination are the specialized examinations, these specialized examinations are done when an anomaly is suspected on basis of history or biochemical abnormalities, and include examinations like fetal Doppler ultrasound, biophysical profile score, fetal echocardiography, which is the topic of our lecture today, fetal neurosonography, skeletal surveys from the point of view of skeletal dysplasia. So these are all specialized examinations. And the fourth type is called as limited examination. A limited examination is done when a specific question needs to be answered. For example, in a case of a bleeding patient, is there any fetal heart activity? Or in a patient in labor, what is the fetal presentation? And these limited examinations are appropriate only when a prior complete examination is on record. So you can see these four types of examinations. For the limited examination, all of these require a study of the fetal anatomy. And the point I'm trying to make is that you need to know, if you are going to be doing obstetric ultrasound examinations, we need to be able to look at fetal anatomy in all examinations. And so there's nothing like an obstetric ultrasound examination with only biometry or Leica or placenta. Each and every obstetric ultrasound examination needs us to look at the fetal anatomy. And so we need to be conversant with looking at fetal anatomy. And when we do an obstetric scan and we understand that we need to look at the fetal anatomy, one of the most important things to look at is the fetal heart. The fetal heart anatomy is perceived as the most difficult part of the fetal anatomical survey, and rightly so. But at the same time, I would like to say that it is there is a learning curve which is involved for looking at the fetal heart. And once you are past that learning curve, then it becomes easy like anything else. Right. Now, when you look at the fetal heart, there is a difference between looking at the fetal heart at the anomaly scan and looking at the fetal heart during fetal echocardiography. Every study of the fetal heart is not echocardiography, fetal echo. And when we do anomaly scan, we are looking at the fetal heart, but we are not doing an entire fetal echocardiography. And so the fetal echocardiography is a more detailed study as compared to the heart examination during the anomaly scan or the standard or the routine second or third trimester scan. So when we look at the fetal heart scan during anomaly scan, we are going to be doing B mode study, and we're going to be doing a color Doppler study. In B mode, we look at the fetal situs, the four chamber view, the left ventricular outflow tract, the right ventricular outflow tract, LVOT and RVOT as we call it, the three vessel view, the three vessel trachea view. So these are the B mode sections that we need to obtain at the anomaly scan. And then we need to use color on certain sections like on the interventricular septum, the LVOT, the three vessel trachea view, or the four chamber view. And this comprises the study of fetal heart at the anomaly scan. But when we look at fetal echocardiography, that's more in detail, because we'll be not only looking at B mode and color, but we also need to do the spectral Doppler and M mode. There are optional methods like tissue Doppler, 3D techniques. These remain optional, and these are necessary and compulsory. So let us, in this next two or three slides, I'm going to list what constitutes echocardiography. First is the B mode. And in B mode, we need to look at the four chamber view. Now, the heart has got four chambers and it has got outflows, the LVOT and the RVOT. So in order to look at the four chambers, there is only one view, and that is the four chamber view. All the other views, if you see, the LVOT view, which is the five chamber view, LVOT, the long axis view, then RVOT, the three vessel view, the transverse aortic arch view, the three vessel trachea view, aortic arch, ductal arch, SVC, IVC, all these views are the other views, are views for the great arteries. So there's only one view for the four chambers, and all the other views are meant for the great arteries. So that's on B mode. And on color Doppler, what do you have? What all views should we see in fetal echo? We're going to put color Doppler on the lateral four chamber view and on the LVOT view. These are meant for ventricular septal defects. And then we're going to put color on the apical four chamber view to look for regurgitation at the AV walls. And then we're going to put color on the three vessel trachea view to look for things like aberrant right subclavian artery, ARSA, or reversed flow in the arches. And then it may be necessary to put color for pulmonary veins. We're going to put color on the foramen ovale to look for direction of the flow on the RVOT, ductal arch, aortic arch, bicable, ductus venosus, and in relevant situations of abnormality. So we're going to put color on a whole lot of views. And then we're going to do spectral Doppler also, to look for velocities and waveforms in the LVOT, RVOT, something called simultaneous arterial and venous Doppler, which I'm not going to elaborate upon here, and the AV wall Doppler, ductus venosus, and in relevant situations of abnormality. So we're going to do spectral Doppler in all these areas, and then M mode, we're going to put on the check for 1:1 atrioventricular events. So what all things are there in fetal echo? The B mode, all these various things, the color Doppler, all these various views, spectral Doppler, all these various places, and the M mode. You can see that fetal echo is much more detailed as compared to the anomaly scan examination, the fetal heart examination at the anomaly scan, which we saw in this particular slide. Right. So now when you start fetal echocardiography, now I would like to say, having said this, I'm supposed to be simplifying fetal echo, not make it appear complicated. But what I would like to say is that though the list appears very long, the actual methodology, once you get the hang of the methodology, it really doesn't take too much time, particularly if you have a favorable fetal position. So though the list looks long and complicated in practice, and once you get used to it, it is not really that difficult. Now, steps in fetal echocardiography. When you actually get started on fetal echo, step number one is, where is the heart situated? That we want to first know whether the heart is situated on the left side or on the right side, or where is the heart situated. And this is done by defining laterality, which means deciding which is the right of the fetus and which is the left of the fetus. So step number one is to find out which is the right side of the fetus and which is the left side of the fetus. Step number two is to establish fetal situs. We'll see this a little more in detail a little later. And step number three is to obtain all those standard recommended views which we had outlined earlier. So step one is the left and right side of the fetus. Step two, the situs. And step three, then we actually get started with the various views. Let's look at step one, which is finding out where the heart is situated. To determine which is the right of the fetus and which is the left of the fetus, we call as defining the laterality. Laterality means which is the right of the fetus or left of the fetus. Now, we should not go by the stomach or the fetal heart position. The stomach is not always to the left. You can't say that this is the stomach is on this side, so that is the fetal left side. No, that is not the way to figure out the left and right side of the fetus. To figure out what is the right and left of the fetus, we need to know where is the head of the fetus, where is the tail of the fetus, and where is the spine of the fetus. For example, if you were to look at this picture here, and this is, now I'm going to ask you, which is this hand, is it the right hand or is it the left hand? What are you going to do? You look at the head, you look at the tail, you look at the spine, you'll imagine how you are lying, you'll imagine yourself lying in this particular position. And then you will say, yes, this is the right hand and this is the left hand. Similarly, let's look at this image here. Which hand is this of person? And then you will say the head is on this side, the tail is on this side, the spine is on top. So if I were to be lying in this particular position, then this is going to be my right hand. So in order to figure out which is right and left of the we are looking at the head, the tail, and the spine. And the same thing we are going to do when we want to find out which is the right and left of the fetus. Only thing is, whereas you are looking at these pictures on when you look at the fetus, you don't have these kind of pictures. Instead, you have the probe. So you use the probe, you sweep your probe across the abdomen, find out where is the head of the fetus, where is the tail of the fetus, where is the spine. Imagine yourself lying in that position and you know which is the right side and which is the left side. So I'm going to put you through an exercise in order to illustrate this particular point. So let's look at this image. The outside line represents the maternal wall, right? So the outer line is the maternal wall. This is the anterior wall, posterior wall, right side and left side. You are doing ultrasound, you can see a cross section of the fetus. This fetus, the spine of the fetus is on the right side here, okay, on the right side here. So, and the fetus is in cephalic presentation. So now you have to tell me which hand of the fetus, which hand of the fetus will be towards the anterior wall of the mother, and which hand is going to be posterior. So you have to imagine the fetus is lying in cephalic presentation and the spine is to the right. So which hand is this now? Yeah. Now let's look at this image. The fetus is in breech presentation and the spine of the fetus is to the left of the mother. Now you have to tell me which hand of the fetus is this? Is it the left hand or the right hand? So now you are going to imagine in the eye of your mind how the fetus is lying. It's in breech. The spine is here to the left. So this hand is going to be the left hand again. Is that clear? And similarly, you have the fetus is in breech here, spine to the right. This will be the right hand of the fetus. So we are going to, we are not going to rely upon the stomach or the heart position. We are going to imagine how the fetus is lying in the fetus, in the abdomen, in the uterus, and then decide which is the right of the fetus and which is the left of the fetus. Now, once you've decided which is the right and which is the left of the fetus, then you have to verify that the stomach is indeed to the left side. Okay, check that the stomach is indeed, and if the stomach is to the left side, then the stomach becomes a marker for the left side in future. So during the rest of the study, if you want to know the right and left, you don't have to go through this whole process in your mind again. You can use the stomach as a marker for the rest of the study, a marker for the left side. Clear? Now, once you know that's the left side, then you have to look at the position of the heart and confirm whether the heart is to the right side or to the left side. There's another way of deciding which is the right and left, which is called as the right palm view, right palm rule of Bronsted. I'm not going to go into it. I find it a bit complicated, so you can go through it on the net. But such a thing is available to decide the right and left side of the fetus. So that was step number one. Step number two is determining the fetal situs. The human body appears symmetric. If you see from outside, it appears symmetric. But it is actually far from symmetric because there is an asymmetric arrangement of organs in the thorax and abdomen. Embryologically, the organs develop in midline. Which organ goes to the right side and which one goes to the left side is decided and occurs later on, what we call as lateralization. And if this lateralization of the organs is incomplete, then the result is a greater degree of symmetry in the body. And this leads to what is called as heterotaxy or situs ambiguous. The heterotaxy syndromes, or also called as situs ambiguous, are due to incomplete lateralization of abdominal and thoracic organs and blood vessels. Right. Now, the normal arrangement of visceral organs and blood vessels in the body is referred to as situs solitus. So when there is a situs solitus, on the right side, you have the right atrium, you have the IVC, and you have most of the liver on the right side. And on the left side, what you have the morphological left atrium, which is joined by the pulmonary veins, the descending aorta, and the stomach. So in normal situs solitus, these particular organs and structures are placed in this particular fashion. Now, we need to understand fetal situs when we do fetal echocardiography, because situs abnormalities are associated with fetal cardiac and non-cardiac abnormalities. And evaluating the situs is an integral and important part of fetal echocardiography. So when you do fetal echocardiography, you first decide the right and left of the fetus, check the position of the heart, and then we're going to look at the fetal situs, because evaluating situs is an important part of fetal echo. How do we evaluate the fetal situs? For that purpose, we need to look at two sections. One is the section through the abdomen, which is the AC section, abdominal circumference section. And the second is a cross-section through the fetal thorax, which is the four-chamber view, which contains the four-chamber view. We are going to look at these two sections in order to decide the fetal situs. When we look at the abdominal section, we are looking at the abdominal situs. And when we look at the thoracic section, we are looking at thoracic situs, and we now generally equate the cardiac situs with the thoracic situs. And if both these are normal, then we are going to say that the situs, fetal situs, is normal. Now we need to look at a little more in detail at both these sections. So first we're going to look at the cross section of the fetal abdomen, the AC section. If I have to look at the section, we're going to draw a midline. The midline is going to be drawn from the spine. Can you see these hyperechoic areas here, dots out here? So this is the spine. This is the vertebral body, and these two are the posterior elements. So we're going to draw a line from the spine to the area of the where the cord enters. Okay, where the cord enters the abdomen, which is a midline. So we're going to draw a line here. And fetal stomach, we expect to be on the left side of the fetal spine. You can see this arrow which I have marked here. What is this arrow here? What is this structure here? Anybody? And that is the umbilical vein out here. And umbilical vein here. Now, and what is this structure here? You can see I have marked out this particular arrow here. And somebody, what is this structure here? That is, yes, it's the left branch of the portal vein. It's the portal vein, and that forms the sickle. Now, so that's the left branch of the portal vein. Then the majority of the liver should be to the right side of the spine. So where is the liver here? Now, you know that this is an intrahepatic structure. Intrahepatic structure. So this is the liver. And this is the bowel here. So if you draw the outline of the liver, it would be something like this. So majority of the liver is to the right side of the spine. What is this structure here now? It's the abdominal aorta here. Abdominal aorta. And what we need to note is that the abdominal aorta is to the left of the spine. Can you see this midline? And it is on the left side of the spine. And what is this structure here now, which I have marked out? Correct responses. So this is the IVC. And what you need to note is that the IVC is to the right of the spine and anterior to the aorta. So this relationship between aorta and IVC is important in order to establish a normal situs, and we need to take note of this relationship. So what we found is stomach here, also liver here, and the aorta-IVC relationship as described here. What is this structure here? Now, can you see a linear structure, hypoechoic with a hyperechoic center here? What is this structure here? That happens to be the right adrenal. Very good. Right adrenal gland. I've got good responses here. Okay. The right adrenal gland. Now, having done that, so if these structures are all normal, then we're going to say abdominal situs is normal. Then we shift our attention to the transverse section of the thorax, the four chamber view. And what are the, and we again going to draw a midline. How do we draw the midline? Through the spine again, you can see the body, vertebral body. And anteriorly, we're going to go through the sternum. This hypoechoic area here is the sternum. The sternum is a large structure, but it appears quite inconspicuous on ultrasound because it is hypoechoic and it's because it's cartilaginous. So we're going to draw a line here. Is a midline. And what we need to note is that 2/3 of the heart and the apex are on the left side, the cardiac axis points to the left side, and that the descending aorta is to the left of the midline. So if these conditions are satisfied, we say that the cardiac or the thoracic situs is normal. And so when both these conditions are, both these views are normal, we are going to say that the fetal situs is normal. Right. Now, there are three types of situs, mainly. Situs solitus, we already saw what that means. Situs inversus, which is mirror imaging. And situs ambiguous, which is also called heterotaxy or heterotaxy syndromes. Now, let's look at fetal situs inversus. On the right side, you're going to have the left side structures, which means the left atrium is here. Descending aorta is on the left side, and the stomach is on the left side. On the right side. And on the left side, you have the morphological right atrium, the IVC, and most of the liver. This we are aware of. And when there is situs ambiguous, findings are variable. There's a mixture of the findings, and they are not as well-defined as they are listed here. And whenever these conditions are not satisfied, we refer to those conditions as situs ambiguous or heterotaxy syndromes. Now, when you look at the section of the upper abdomen, which we had seen just now, I had mentioned that the position of the aorta and IVC is of importance, and it is more reliable for determining situs ambiguous, which can be of two types: right isomerism or left isomerism. Situs ambiguous is of two types: there is right isomerism and left isomerism. So the position of the aorta and IVC is more reliable for determining situs ambiguous than the location of the stomach in the abdomen, whether the stomach is on the right side or on the left side. How is that? So if you look at these images, there is this in situs solitus, that is a normal situs. You have stomach on the left, you have the most of the liver on the right side, you have aorta to the left posterior, and IVC to the right anterior. In situs inversus, it's reversed. You have stomach on the right side, you have most of the liver on the left side, you have aorta, which is to the right posterior, and IVC to the left anterior. Now, in right isomerism and left isomerism, both these lower ones are heterotaxy syndromes or situs ambiguous, and they're of two types: right isomerism, left isomerism. In right isomerism, you may have stomach on either side, but what you have is stomach, the aorta and the IVC both on the same side of the midline, and that is called as juxtaposition of the aorta and IVC, and they may both be on the right side or they may both be on the left side. And then in left isomerism, you have this aorta here and you have a venous structure here, which is not the IVC. The IVC, instead, the IVC is actually absent. There is interruption of the intrahepatic portion of the IVC. And instead, you have this vein, which is the azygous vein, which is situated on the right side of the midline, posterior to the aorta. Sometimes you can, less commonly, you can also have the hemiazygous, which is situated on the left side of the midline, posterior to the aorta. Usually, you have the azygous. So what I would like to emphasize is looking properly at the relationship of the aorta and the IVC. So when you do fetal echocardiography, when looking at the situs, we have to look at this section and the aorta-IVC relationship properly. Right. Then we come, having done this preliminary work, we come to step three, which is obtaining those several standard recommended views. And we are going to start with the four-chamber view. Now, the four-chamber view, if you look at this heart, this diagram has been given to me by my Dr. Disha. You can see her illustrations out here, this her logo out here. I have borrowed that from her, this diagram from her. Now, what this diagram shows you is that the four-chamber view is a section through the lowermost part of the fetal heart. There is nothing below the fetal heart, below the four-chamber view, except, as we will see later, the coronary sinus. But otherwise, the four-chamber heart is the lowest section of the heart. This is how it looks. And the aortic walls, the pulmonary wall, the three-vessel view, or the other views are above, means towards the head end of the fetus as compared to the four-chamber view. And in the four-chamber view, what are we going to look at? The position of the heart, the axis of the heart, size of the fetal heart, structure of the fetal heart, and whether it is functioning properly or whether it is beating properly or not. So let's look first at the position of the heart in the thorax in the four-chamber view. Now, the position of the heart within the chest is separate from the fetal cardiac axis and is independent of the cardiac axis. And abnormalities of fetal heart position and heart axis may occur independently and should be reported separately. So how do we decide the position of the heart? So for that purpose, we're going to draw a midline by identifying the spine and the sternum as we outlined earlier. And most of the heart we expect lies in the left side of the chest. And the descending aorta lies to the left side of the midline. So we take note of these things. Now, what is the position of the left atrium? The left atrium is the most posterior chamber in the heart, and it lies just anterior to the descending aorta, and which in turn lies just anterior to the spine. So that is the position of the left atrium. And what is the position of the right ventricle? It is the most anterior chamber and is present behind the sternum. So when you look at the fetal heart, we make a note of all these points. Next, we are going to look at the axis of the heart. How do we decide the axis of the heart? Again, we are going to draw a midline, and then we are going to draw another line through the interventricular septum. Now, this heart here has an apex. It has a base. The apex is formed by the ventricle, the right ventricle, and the base is formed by the atria. So we're going to draw a line through the interventricular septum, and then you have this particular angle. We refer to that as the cardiac axis, and so the heart normally lies with the interventricular septum at about 45 degrees to the midline of the thorax. The range is 45 plus or minus 20 degrees, or you can take it as 25 to 70 degrees. And that is the axis of the heart. Now, that was normal axis. Excuse me. Now, this heart has an abnormal axis. The spine is here, posterior. This is anterior. This is the apex of the heart. This is the base of the heart. And you can see that the axis should have been something like this instead. 90 degrees. So this is altered. So the axis has deviated to the left side. This is left axis deviation, which is found in certain conditions like tetralogy of Pado, coarctation of aorta, Epstein's anomaly. And similarly, you will have right axis deviation in certain conditions like DORV, AVST, common atrium. Need not memorize this. It will come automatically at some point. But we need to see whether the axis appears normal or whether it is abnormal. Now, this is a grossly abnormal axis. Sometimes the abnormalities can be more subtle. And then we use terms to describe the position of the fetal heart. Dextrocardia, dextroposition, dextroversion, levocardia, mesocardia. These are general terms that are used to describe the position of the heart. We don't use positions, words like levoposition, levoversion commonly at all. Right. So dextrocardia refers to a heart that is located in the right side of the chest, regardless of its axis. So any heart on the right side of the chest, irrespective of the axis, is dextrocardia. The normal position we know is like this. The heart is pointing, most of the heart is to the left side, it is pointing to the left side. But when there is dextrocardia, then it could be either of these two situations. You can see here, the heart has got shifted to the right side, but is pointing to the left side. And here the heart has got shifted to the right side, but is pointing to the left side. And both these are situations of dextrocardia. But when the heart is pointing to the left side, then it is so called as dextroposition. And when the heart is pointing to the right side, is shifted to the right side, but is pointing to the right side, axis is pointing to the right side, we call that as dextroversion. So dextroposition and dextroversion are both dextrocardias. I'll show you examples of dextroposition and dextrocardia. Now, dextroposition is a heart on the right side of the chest with axis pointing to the left side. So, and this usually happens when there is an extrinsic push on the heart. So here you can see there's a right side, the heart has got pushed to the right side due to a large CCAM, which is cystic adenomatoid malformation, and which has caused expansion of the lung and pushed the heart to the right side, so much so that the heart is now touching the right lateral wall of the chest. But if you draw a line through the interventricular septum, you can see that the axis still points to the left side. And so this is dextroposition. Here is another example of dextroposition where the heart is on the left side of the thorax, you have the stomach, and all these here are the bowel loops. It's not the lung. You can see the heterogeneity here. And this is a bit of the liver. So you can see all these structures have pushed the heart to the right side to the right lateral wall. But the axis is still pointing to the left side. And so this is dextroposition. This is CDH, congenital diaphragmatic hernia. In this particular image, you can see the midline here. The heart is pointing to the left side and is present in the left side of the chest due to a small hypoplastic. The shift in the heart position is due to a small hypoplastic lung on the right side here. And a similar situation here where the right lung is completely absent. So the heart is shifted to the right side, but still pointing to the left side. And so this is dextroposition. Dextroversion is when the heart is placed on the right side and axis is pointing to the right side. But here you can see that the left ventricle is still on the left side, right ventricle on the left side, and the left atrium with its pulmonary veins is on the left side, and is the right atrium on the right side. So there is no chamber, there is no mirror imaging of the chambers. It's just that the heart is pointing to the right side, but the chambers are still in proper position. And so this is a dextroversion. And this is another example of a dextroversion where the heart is on the right side, pointing to the right side, but there is a chamber, mirror imaging of the chambers, because the right ventricle is on the left side, the left ventricle on the right side, and same thing with the atria. So this is also dextroversion, these two different types of dextroversion. And when there is dextroversion, usually there are cardiac anomalies which are associated. Whereas dextroposition is often due to extracardiac issues. Levocardia means the heart is on the left side, and this often refers usually to the normal position of the heart. But you can have levocardia in an abnormal situation, such as in this case, you can see most of the heart is to the left side, is pointing to the left side. But if you see the area behind the heart and the aorta IVC, the aorta and this particular structure here, there is no IVC proper, stomach is on the right side. So this is a situs ambiguous, a case of situs ambiguous and left isomerism. So here you have a levocardia, but in an abnormal situation. So you can have levocardia in both normal and abnormal situations. Another word that we need to be familiar with is mesocardia. Mesocardia means the heart is not pointing to the left side or to the right side. Instead, it's pointing in front. And so, and in this particular case, mesocardia is associated with an abnormal heart. There is a symmetry here. So probably this is a case of an isomerism. It's an abnormal heart. And this mesocardia, so the axis, you can see the heart is pointing straight in front. this case of mesocardia is due to extra cardiac abnormality, which is chaos. What is chaos? Congenital high airways obstruction, which means that there is atresia of the larynx or the trachea, and because of that, the secretions in both the lungs remain inside. Lungs become very large and hyperechoic, and they squeeze the heart, make it positioned in the center, and the heart size becomes small because of the extrinsic compression. So you have this mesocardia due to, for the first case was mesocardia due to cardiac anomaly. This is due to an extra cardiac anomaly. And sometimes, like in this case, you can have a mesocardia with a completely normal heart. So it is just a normal variation. So you have mesocardia in all these various situations. Right. Now, some people, you can also use, instead of using the terms, you can also say that the heart is located on the right side of the chest and axis pointing to the left side, or located on that side, axis point on the left side. Instead of using these terms, but at the same time, you need to be familiar with the terms because they are often used in literature and in papers which you will read when you will come across when you read. Excuse me. When you look at the fetal heart on magnified on the screen, you can see the that is quite large. The heart looks quite large, but actually, it's just 2 centimeters at 19 weeks. So that speaks for the quality of imaging which is available today. Now, when we look at the size of the heart, it is a subjective and visual assessment. We don't need to measure each and every time. But if in doubt, then you can measure. And there are two ways of measuring the heart. You can draw a circumference around the heart and another circumference of the for the thorax. And then you can measure the area of the heart upon area of the thorax. You can also measure the circumference of the heart upon circumference of the thorax. That is called as the CT ratio. And that is normally 0.55, ranges from 0.5 to 0.6. But you must remember that these are only rough guides and not precise measurements. The heart size can be bigger than normal. It can be smaller than normal. This is normal and this is a bigger than normal heart. And cardiomegaly. But then you can also have a heart which is small in size due to extrinsic compression, like chaos we saw earlier. And in this case, it is due to a congenital cystic adenomatoid malformation, which is causing compression in a small heart. So you can have a small heart also. Now, in this particular case, you can see that it's the thorax which is small. The abdomen is bulging, and this is due to a skeletal dysplasia, because of which in the cross-section, it appears falsely like cardiomegaly. So it's not a heart which is small, it's large, but it is the thorax which is small. So this is an apparent cardiomegaly. It's not real cardiomegaly due to a small chest, and this may appear in severe skeletal dysplasias. Right. Now let's look at the structure of the heart in the four-chamber view. You can see here the position of the valves. The four-chamber view is the lowest section of the heart, and you have the AV valves in that section. The aortic valve is above that, and the pulmonary valve is above that. And you have different views at different levels. The four-chamber view here, the five-chamber view here, the three-vessel view here, and the transverse aortic arch view here. So you have different views at different cross-sections. But the point that I would like you to notice that the AV valves are at the lower level, above that is the aortic valve, and above that is the pulmonary valve. And so if you want to look at the outflow tracts and you are at the four-chamber view, then you will have to angulate your probe towards the head end of the fetus. And then there are further maneuvers of probe rotation which need to be done in order to get the LVOT and the RVOT satisfactorily. Right. So the four-chamber view should be at the level of the crux. Now we have introduced a new word here, the crux. What is the crux? This cross in the center of the heart is referred to as the crux and comprises of the interventricular septum, the interatrial septum, the tricuspid valve, and the mitral valve. So this cross here, the crux, and the four-chamber view should be at the level of the crux. If you are not at the level of the crux, if you are below the level of the crux, you are looking at the coronary sinus. Now, the two images look very similar. But this gap here is the foramen ovale, and this gap here, okay, is the coronary sinus. Blood flows normally in the heart from the right atrium to the left atrium through the foramen ovale. So direction of blood flow is in this direction. But in the coronary sinus, the blood flows from the left to the right side in a reverse direction. So we should not mistake the coronary sinus and we need to not mix that up for the four-chamber view. Now, you can see here, this is the spine, posterior, anterior, left, right, left ventricle, right ventricle, left atrium, right atrium. And you can see this gap here. So this is the coronary sinus. This is not at the four-chamber, it's a little below the four-chamber view. And blood is going to flow from the left to the right side here. Now, and in this section, the spine is here, posterior, anterior. The left ventricle is here, right ventricle is here. This is the left side and the right side. And what I would like to show you is that in the coronary sinus, the blood flows from the left to the right. And through the foramen ovale, here the foramen ovale, the blood is flowing from the right to the left side. Okay. So this fine point, I would like to introduce to you at this particular point. Now, if you go a little higher than the crux, that is the four-chamber view, then you will start coming across the aorta. Aortic valve, you know, is a little above, so aorta. And if you look at this, the posterior side, there's the anterior, left and the right side. And you can see the aorta coming from the left ventricle towards the right side. And this aorta has got two lines. The anterior wall is continuous with the interventricular septum, called as the aortoseptal continuity. You must have heard about it. And the posterior wall continues as the left, as the mitral valve. So this is at a section a little above the four-chamber view. So at the crux, you have the correct four-chamber view. A little above you go, you find the aorta coming up, and this is the five-chamber view. And if you go a little below, you are at the level of the coronary sinus. And then these three views are only within about 4 millimeters of each other in the second trimester. So if you are holding the probe here and the fetus is down here, it is just a little bit of an angulation. And the one thing you'll realize is that doing obstetric ultrasound and looking at the fetal heart in particular is all about fine movements. And so as a diversion, I would say your grip on the probe needs to be correct. Many people have an abnormal grip and a wrong grip, and that does not allow them to make fine movements, and it becomes very difficult to get sections. So the grip on the probe is very important. That was a diversion here. The four-chamber view is of three types: the apical, the basal, and the lateral. In the apical view, the apex is pointing in front, so the beam enters the heart from the apex. And if the spine is posterior, if the spine is anterior, then the heart is facing downwards and you get what is called as the basal four-chamber view. Means the beam is entering the heart from the base of the heart. If the heart is in a lateral position, then you have what is called as a lateral four-chamber view. And the beam is entering the heart from either one or the other lateral side. So these are the three four-chamber views that you have. And the best view, as you know, is the apical four-chamber view. Next best is the lateral four-chamber view. And most people would find the basal four-chamber view as rather unfavorable to assess the fetal heart. In doing fetal echocardiography optimally, both the apical and the lateral four-chamber views are required in order to complete the study optimally. Right. Now let's look at the structure of the heart in the four-chamber view. In the mid-trimester, the fetal heart looks symmetric. So you have two atria equal in size, and then you have two ventricles, which are approximately equal in size. You have two AV valves that open equally and symmetrically, the mitral and the tricuspid. And then in the right ventricle, you have the moderator band, which is a thick muscle bundle of variable appearance at the apex here. That's the moderator band. And outside, you can see a thin layer of pericardial fluid, and which forms a hypoechoic or a dark line around the heart. And if it is more than 2 millimeters in thickness, we call it as pericardial effusion, but not if it's an oblique section. If the section is oblique, it falsely appears, may appear to be large, and then that would not be pericardial effusion. The pulmonary veins, the right and the left pulmonary veins, we need to identify, and at the four chamber we have the inferior pulmonary veins that we see. And we need to see that the pulmonary veins indeed connect with the left atrium, not just are near it, because then it may be an anomalous pulmonary venous drainage that we are looking at. The crux, the center of the heart, which we had seen earlier, the point to note here is, a very important point to note here, is that the tricuspid valve inserts a little apically as compared to the mitral valve, which inserts a little towards the base. So the tricuspid inserts here and the mitral inserts here. And so there is what is called as an offset or a differential insertion, and that is the normal situation. If you have a loss in offset, you have to look carefully because you may be dealing with some cardiac abnormality. So looking at the offset is an important part of the study of the four-chamber view. Now, whichever valve inserts more apically, that valve is the tricuspid valve, and that ventricle is the right ventricle. So the tricuspid valve belongs to the right ventricle. If you have the apically inserted valve on the left side, then that means this is the right ventricle morphological, dealing with some abnormality. Then we need to look at the interventricular septum, which should be intact from the apex to the crux. There is a thick part of the septum, which is the muscular. There's a thin part of the septum, which is the inlet part of the septum. And when you see in the apical four-chamber view, then this thin part of the septum sometimes may not be seen and may appear as if it's a VST. We should not try to diagnose these inlet VSTs in the apical four-chamber view. Can you see here? This looks like a VST, but it is not a VST. You can see the same heart when I see in the lateral four-chamber view. You can see that it is actually present here and there is no VST at all. Okay? Right. And then we look at the interatrial septum. There are three parts to the interatrial septum. The lower part is the septum primum here, which attaches to the crux. The upper part portion is the septum secundum here. Okay, and this portion is the septum secundum, and foramen ovale, which is in the middle portion of the interatrial septum, is a defect in the mid portion of the septum secundum. And the foramen ovale is guarded by the flap of foramen ovale, which is derived from septum primum, which lies in the left atrium. So that was on the interatrial septum. Now, what we need to realize is that the four-chamber view during systole looks quite different from the four-chamber view in diastole. In systole, you can see the crux properly, you can see the offset properly, but these features you cannot identify during diastole. When the heart is beating, it's a good time to see this various anatomy, the opening of the walls and the flap of foramen ovale on the left side. That is because the blood is flowing from the right atrium to the left atrium, and so the flap of the foramen ovale is on the left side. You can see that also that the aorta is on the left side of the midline. Here, if you see, there's a tiny white hyperechoic spot here. That is the crista terminalis. This is a normal structure. It appears like a small mass rising from the posterior wall of the right atrium. It is actually a muscular ridge near the SVC, extending from the SVC to the IVC. So that is a normal structure. How does the heart look when you put color on the four-chamber view? Most people would find it confusing. They don't understand what is happening exactly. So I'm going to show you how the color goes in the four-chamber view. The red is on top, so that is flow towards the probe. The blue is on top, so that is flow towards the probe. So the blue is filling of the ventricles during ventricular systole, the ventricular diastole, and the red is blood in the aorta during ventricular systole. So you have red, blue, red, blue, red, blue, red, blue. And if you see the tricuspid valve here, okay, whenever the aorta is in red, you do not see any red color across the tricuspid valve, which means that there is no tricuspid regurgitation. Okay, I would like you to observe this closely. If I were to freeze this image, okay, you can see that there is no tricuspid regurgitation here. That means if there is a red, when there's a red, there is no red stream coming here. So there is no tricuspid regurgitation. This is ventricular systole. Now let's look at this image. The red is on top, so that is red is flow towards the probe. So the red is the ventricular diastole. This blue is due to ventricular systole and blood in the aorta. But can you see this red, blue coming here? What is that? Whenever you have a blue here, this is, you get a blue here, and that is tricuspid regurge. Okay, here you can see when there's a blue here, there's also a blue here. Okay, here. So this is tricuspid regurgitation. Okay, now this is a small regurgitation. Small regurgitations may not be important, but very often people have not seen or do not know how to see the regurgitation. So I'm just showing you how it would look. And if you put a spectral sample volume here, you will find this regurgitation here, which is in the direction opposite that of ventricular filling, which are these two waves, the E wave and the A wave. So this is ventricular filling, and tricuspid regurg is always in the direction opposite that. We need to look at the function of the heart. Is the heart, are the two ventricles contracting briskly and equally? Are the two AV walls opening freely? And so we need to satisfy ourselves on the function of the heart. You can see here that the heart is not contracting properly. It's a dilated heart, very poor squeeze, and this happens to be dilated cardiomyopathy. So we've looked at the four-chamber view. And if you look at the four-chamber view, what percentage of defects of the heart are we going to pick up? Do you think it is going to be 80%, or what do you think is going to be? Would anybody like to answer? What is the detection? What percentage of the defects heart cardiac and cardiac, what percentage of cardiac diseases could you pick up? Okay. So the answer is only 12 to 40%. So clearly we need to look at the heart better. And so we need to look at the outflow tract views also. And with the outflow tract views, we can pick up about 40 to 70% of the defects, and which brings us to the great artery views. But then that is not for this lecture, okay, because that's another big topic. And with this, I would like to end the lecture. But before ending the lecture, I would like to offer my thanks and offer credit to Dr. Amar for offering me this platform and for being able to relate to all of you. And again, I would like to credit Dr. Disha Lokanwala for enabling this lecture. She is the one who made it possible, and for giving me her wonderful illustrations from her Disha Radiology illustrations and her Instagram. And I urge you all to go through this Instagram page. There are more than 4,500 followers, and for a good reason, because the very complicated topics have been simplified by beautiful diagrams. So getting a concept becomes really easy with those illustrations. So I would direct you to this site. And then once again, our contact details are placed here for Chikitsa Ultrasound, and this is the website. The whole programs are announced in advance, and 6-month and 12-month fellowships are not always open. So for those who are interested, you can make inquiries on that. And thank you once again for a patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Badde. That was an amazing talk. There are so many concepts that you made really simple. And we would definitely want to have you once again over our channel to discuss more ultrasound topics. I know the kind of work you're doing at Chikitsa is phenomenal. So we would like that that work reaches more people. And we would love to have you again. Thank you once again for sparing time today and doing this on a weekend, an odd time in India. But thank you again for doing this. Thank you, Disha, for again coordinating and enabling this webinar. Thank you, everybody who joined us live for this session. If you're new here, my name is Dr. Anirudh Badade. I'm the founder of this radiology teaching website, radiogyan.com. You can check out all our radiology resources on the website. We do these sessions every Saturday. Next Saturday, we have a fun radiology games night. I am personally very excited about it. So make sure you join us next Saturday at a similar time. And you can subscribe to the channel so that you get updates and turn on the notification bell so that the next time we are live, you don't miss the update. If you registered using email, you'll get a feedback form. Do let us know how did we do and what can we do to improve whatever we are doing. And you can also leave your comments in the chat section in the YouTube. Thank you, Dr. Badde, once again, and hoping to see all of you in our next video. Bye-bye.
Yeah, bye-bye. Thank you.